Je remercie beaucoup le juge Guimard pour cette brillante intervention et pour avoir accepté notre invitation. Et oui, sans doute que le contentieux français est en ce moment un des plus riches contentieux concernant le COVID qui se trouve devant la Cour. Il faut aussi dire que la Cour, peut-être il n'y a pas beaucoup de nos collègues dans l'auditoire qui le sachent, la Cour, elle a changé la politique déjà de communication des cas. Donc, elle communique d'abord les cas qui ont un certain conséquence, qui ont un certain impact, comme on dit en anglais, sur le pays ou sur, en général, la situation des droits de l'homme en Europe. Et ça fait que, certainement, la Cour faisait ça même avant. Donc, on avait des affaires qui ont été jugées très rapidement, des affaires qui étaient importantes sur les conséquences des droits de l'homme. Mais ça est devenu une politique. Et on a vu la vitesse avec laquelle on a communiqué et on a même décidé dans certains cas. Le juge Guimard a fait référence à cette affaire roumaine, je ne l'ai plus citée, concernant Monsieur Terhesh et l'article 5 et le fait que le confinement n'appartient pas à cet article. Donc, en général, on a adopté des décisions de irrecevabilité, mais ils sont déjà adoptés. Et je pense que c'est important pour c'est important pour les gens qui nous écoutent de la Roumanie aussi de l'Europe de savoir que ce cas Zambrano et le concept même de l'abus de requête qu'il implique, qui n'est pas si connu par le public. Donc, on voit que la Cour applique cette notion de l'abus de requête. Chaque fois où on se trouve dans une multiplication on se trouve dans une tentative, dans une idée de bloquer la Cour, telle qu'elle était le cas dans cette affaire, et peut-être de cette manière, la Cour, elle se défend contre la possibilité que ça se passe avec des autres requérants dans des futurs qui montent de telle affaire ou tel mouvement. Voilà, donc c'est vrai aussi ce qu'on avait dit avant, c'est une crise majeure qui touche tous les articles de la Convention et donc nous, on est censé les trouver en équilibre. Maintenant, pour faire la tradition, je vais le faire toujours en français parce que le professeur Cosmin Cercel, il est aussi éduqué en Roumanie et en France. Donc, il était éduqué à l'université de Bucarest et à l'université Panthéon-Sorbonne où il a fait aussi son doctorat et après il a fait aussi des études postdoctorales. Et maintenant, après un parcours académique qu'il a mené dans plusieurs autres universités, il est professeur à l'université de Nottingham. Donc, Professor Cherchell will talk about pandemic exception and the law between text and context. I have to say that he's teaching the theory of law, introduction in law, and also comparative constitutional law. You have the floor, Professor Cherchell.
Okay, so thank you very much. I'm very happy to be invited. Thank you, Julia, for inviting me. It's not every day that I get to be in the same virtual room, at least with judges from the European Court of Human Rights. So I think this is quite important for me. And I think it's quite important as a more general trend. I think Julia mentioned it before, the fact that we need to have some sort of a way of connecting perhaps the field of inquiry and what I'm going to say in a bit, you know, the field of critical inquiry, philosophy, theory, legal theory, to the field of practice. And I think that the question it is also because I don't think that we speak enough to each other up to a point. And I think that there is also another point that I would want to raise from the very beginning in order to kind of give you a sense of where I'm trying to go to. Also, the fact that we're sort of seeing this sort of lack of relationship, perhaps, or, you know, reflection on history and perhaps philosophical matters. And unfortunately, the past is sort of, you know, catching up with us. My point is, I'm not here to speak as a lawyer of European human rights law. I'm much more here present as to speak a bit as a legal historian. Now, I'm a specific type of legal historian. I come from a tradition that is called critical legal studies, which unfortunately didn't find quite a lot of roots within on the continent. But basically, what I'm going to try to explore a bit, it is the question of context, and to give you a bit of a sense of where I feel that we unfortunately are. And from this point of view, I think that it is really not a very difficult task that any sort of judges under these particular conditions are going to face, actually. But so much more judges of one of the most important jurisdictions in Europe and perhaps in the world as well. And I think this is sort of a difficult task to deal with because it's for the first time, I think that we have actually the whole world, but you know what concerns me more is Europe under emergency legislation, under emergency legislation being issued since March, perhaps February 2020. And it is for the first time that we have this since the end of World War II. And I think this is something which is quite important. Now, what I'm going to try to say, to bring a bit to on the table, it is the sort of historical weight that it is behind us. Now, we have a long theory, experience of emergency legislation in Europe, which could go back to, if we wanted to go back, we can go back to the French Revolution, we can go even back furthermore to the dictatorship, to the institution of dictatorship in Rome. But the way in which we have been theorizing it during the past years, and it started with around 2003, 2004, once we had to respond to the terrorist threats after 2001, we have been keeping to a specific way of theorizing emergency and emergency legislation as something which is essentially conservative. Essentially conservative in a sense that these are measures which are going to be there only for a temporary period of time, and then when we're going to get back to normal. And I'm referring here to one article by John Farajan and Pasquale Paschino, which was very influential article called "The Laws of Exception: A Typology of Emergency Legislation." Now, my point and my general point, and when I'm going to try to explain why I'm making this claim, my point is that this is not entirely true. I think it becomes perhaps visible to us, and it's probably one of the good things. Well, if there is anything positive about it, about the virus, deadly virus looming around, it is the fact that we're going to be able to see that perhaps emergency has a very important place within the history of our legal communities. And when I speak, when I'm saying this, I'm just, you know, I just wanted to bring you a couple of examples from the past. And if we're looking at the European legal history after the French Revolution, going to see that basically this institution of emergency legislation, the first one which emerged in France, it was called l'état de siège, so the state of siege, circulated all across Europe. And it was used in important moments, 1848, once again, all across Europe. The Romanian, for instance, just to give you an example, the Romanian first instantiation of what we call the state of siege originates from a translation of the French state of siege of legislation of 1849, and it emerged in Romania as a part of the code for military justice written in 1852. So I think it's we can see that, you know, this traveled relatively fast for those particular periods of time, and I think it is a specific technology of dealing with threats. Threats to the to the constitution, but more than that to the state itself. Now, if we're going a bit further in time, we're going to see that there is a constant, and this can be demonstrated, in development of emergency from 1914 onwards. And from 1914 onwards, most of the countries on the continent and even on the other side of of the channel, they would use emergency legislation for various reasons, especially because of the war, but later on in order to deal with various forms of economic instability. And I'm thinking here of Germany of the 1920s and 30s. I'm also thinking here of Belgium. I'm also thinking here of France in the 30s when the crisis hit, the crisis of 1929. Obviously, Romania. And we can see that there is a, according to what I have worked so far, there was only one country in Europe during the interwar which never used emergency legislation, and that was Czechoslovakia. But otherwise, it was used everywhere. It was used in order to repress social unrest. It was used to deal with financial crisis. And we can perhaps make some sort of typology of countries which used more emergency legislation than others. And we can see here, for instance, Romania between, you know, I've done some calculations, Romania between 1916, when it was for the first time used the state of siege, up to 1928, the state of siege was declared at least 16 times. And there were areas of the territory of the country which had been constantly under the state of siege. And I'm thinking here of Bessarabia. But then you would have state of siege emerging, being declared back in 1936, and then 1938. And in 1938, you would also have the dictatorship instituted by King Karl. Now, what I'm trying to say is that basically you're going to see, if we're looking at the history of the interwar at least, each time when the state of siege is used, after that, you're going to end up with some form of prolongation of those measures, which can go as far as to turn into a full dissolution of liberal legality, basically, of forms of constitutional law, of forms of constitutional protection, of protections of human rights, and so on and so forth. Now, we might have imagined that after 1945, we have learned the lesson from that. But it wasn't the case, and it wasn't the case not only for socialist countries, for obvious reasons, for the socialist countries, but it wasn't the case for other countries either. Emergency legislation was used, as you would know, of course, in France at the end of the 1950s. It was used in Italy. It was used during the troubles within the United Kingdom, and in Germany during the 1970s as well. Now, I'm not saying that emergency legislation is bad. I'm not trying to make that sort of argument. I'm just saying that actually we need to keep an eye on the uses of emergency legislation, because it has, and it comes with that history. And it comes with that history behind it, which basically in some particular contexts can turn quite ugly. And when I'm saying that, I'm also keeping in mind the specific context, political, general, global political context that we have, and we have been having perhaps since 2015. And I'm thinking here of what we call and what we have has been coined as being populism, this presence or this reenactment of the far right ideologies in Europe and beyond Europe, this topos of this tropes of returning to the nation, to blood and soil ideology, and so on and so forth, which are specifically connected and related, and we can discuss about this, to a specific way of understanding the state, citizenship, and as being limited. And obviously, that goes hand in hand with a specific disdain for human rights. For human rights is precisely the rights of human beings, which don't really have any sort of other, you know, character. Now, I'm not going to enter into the polemics related to Giorgio Agamben. I'm just wanted to say that because Giorgio Agamben, since February 2020, he kept on writing quite a lot on the particular measures that have been taken by the states in order to tackle COVID. And I think he got it completely wrong. And he got it completely wrong. And perhaps I would say that, you know, that there might be some sort of fundamental philosophical problems with his understanding of the exception. But still, I would give him the credit that he was able to point towards an important part of the history of our legal communities and then of our law in Europe. And it is this sort of specific practice which stays with us, this practice of suspending the normal process of the law, whatever we mean by the normal process of the law. And we can discuss about this during the question part. But I think it is important to keep an eye on that. And when I'm saying that, I'm saying that there is something, and theorists are presenting it. I'm thinking here of Adam Green, who they are talking about permanent emergencies. Already, Ferrajon and Pasquino, they were hinting towards a tendency of what they call embeddedness of emergencies. So, basically, these measures that are being that are taken during the times of emergency or of real emergency, let's put it this way, or real threat, they stay with us. And they stay with us because either they are embedded within, I don't know, administrative law, criminal legislation, criminal procedure legislation, and so on and so forth. On one hand, or they can slowly stay with us in the ways in which we interpret and relate to rights. And I think this is a very important thing to consider within the practice at this moment in time, within the practice. The decisions that are going to be given now, they are not going to be effective only for a shorter period of time. They are going to stay with us for later on. And basically, I think that this is something quite important because it shows in this moment of crisis and exception, it shows how actually the legal discourse is shifting. And these shifts are going to stay with us for a long period of time. So to make a long story short, I think that the question is, that there are two points that I would want to raise. Is one of the fact that to become aware of perhaps the potential danger which lies within emergency legislation in the light of its history, and the second point would be the fact that emergency is not something which is simply temporary. It is something which has an inertia, and even though theoretically, it has been conceived, especially by constitutional theorists, emergency has been conceived as precisely distinct from revolution or distinct from constitutional change, precisely because at the end of the day, emergency legislation means that constitutions cannot be changed during the emergency. My point would be that perhaps we have to think that actually all important changes in societies in Europe took place under periods of crisis. And periods of crisis, at the end of the day, they have been accompanied in a way or another by emergency legislation. So once again, I take an example from Romania, for instance. Before Ceausescu regime fell on in the morning of it was 10th of December to 22nd of December 1989, there was a state of emergency declared at the television on the whole territory of the country. 15 minutes later, the socialist regime fell. But I think this is quite important to keep an eye on this. 1938 emergency legislation was passed sine die in February by King Karl II. 3 days later, he announced the instauration of dictatorship. I'm not saying that these sort of things are going to happen. They have to happen. They are bound to happen, and so on and so forth. But what I'm saying is that we are in a particular situation of many crises coming together. And the second one, the second point is we have this sort of history of emergency. And it is a difficult task to precisely find the way or the right way of dealing with what we call the COVID at the end of the day, because we are dealing with a health crisis with means which are legal means. And the legal means, they are there with their own history, with their own memorial weight. And this memorial weight and this history might block us from perhaps understanding what is really going on in socio-political medical terms, actually. So, and that's why I think, for instance, that's why I think Agamben got it very wrong, because I think that he cannot really understand, or that there are many people in that camp who can't really understand the real scientifically proved threat of the virus. That's why I found very interesting what Julia was saying about Achille Mbembe. About the question of necropolitics. There is also this dimension here in which basically, and which living in UK for a while, I recall very well what was the position back in February 2020, when it was said that, you know, we're going to be fine just by washing our hands, and we don't really have to do anything. We just need to carry
on. I don't hear you well.
Can you hear me now?
Okay, yeah. Yes, now at the end.
Up. Am I all right? Okay, so. Okay. Okay, good. So, these are the problems. This is where we are. I just want to end with a quote from Ronald Dworkin. And it is really perhaps something which might sum up a bit, you know, the everything that I wanted to say. And it goes like this, is that, just a second, because a judge's duty is to interpret legal history he finds, not to invent a better history. I know that this quote was made in a very different context and, you know, within the intellectual constellation of Dworkin, in which basically he was arguing for the necessity of integrity in the law. But what I'm trying to say here, it's also perhaps, you know, my point would be that we need to keep an eye on this sort of historical presence and this sort of historical weight of emergency legislation. And I think this is, under these conditions, it is a very difficult task that you're having before, and we're all having before us, especially as lawyers, because I think at some point in time we might be facing some serious challenges to liberal legality. So I just stop here.
Yeah, thank you very much for this extremely interesting theory, nuancing all the elements of the emergency and departing with what we have in the calling the classical theory of emergency that I try to say some words. And indeed, you know, maybe Judge Sabato will talk more about Agamben, but his position were quite critical. Just to know that he was at the beginning, at the kind of the beginning of this this notion. Interesting enough, how the notion was developed by Pasquino Pasquale, who is also one of my favorite theories this time in the embedded emergency, and how we try to look, once we have this notion again with us, we try to look at the notion in places where the notion was not searched anymore in academical, in intellectual term. I think this is something quite important. It's something maybe that the pandemic brought to the theory of law, and enrich in this respect the theory of law concerning the emergency. It's a very, very interesting point and presentation. Thank you very much.